Mark chapter 9, beginning verse 43, Jesus Christ says, "If thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having 2 eyes to be cast into hell fire, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched." Outside the city of Jerusalem is the Valley of Hinnom. Generation after generation after generation, the Valley of Hinnom was the city dump for Jerusalem. This is where they brought all of their refuse, their trash, their garbage, and burned it. Down through all the centuries, through those Old Testament years, the Valley of Hinnom burned without ever going out. Day and night, week in and week out, month in and month out, year in and year out, lifetime in and lifetime out, the fires of the Valley of Hinnom burned. This is where they would bring the bodies of animals when they died. They didn't bother to bury them. They just dumped them in the Valley of Hinnom. When derelicts would die on the streets or in the jails of Jerusalem, they did not bother to bury them. They just dumped their bodies in the Valley of Hinnom and let the fires burn, and the maggots that constantly crawled year after year, let them come and eat upon the bodies and the garbage and all of this. Now Jesus pointed to the Valley of Hinnom, where the fires never went out. The worms constantly crawled and wiggled and crawled, and Jesus said, "Now that's what hell's like, when the fire is never quenched, and the worm never dies. That's what hell's like." In the passage before us, Jesus used the word hell 3 times. He used the word fire 6 times, and 5 of those 6 times he said that fire is not quenched. Now, as I've studied this passage, the part that for years has captivated me is where Jesus said 3 times, "Their worm dieth not." Their worm dieth not. I've scanned the pages of the commentaries. I've listened to the theologians, and I find that most of them feel that worm is the person's memory. That the memory will never go out, and Jesus meant that when he said their worm would never die. Well, now, if he meant that, why did he say that? Besides that, if it means memory, that's spiritualizing the worm, then you're going to have to spiritualize the fire, too. And that's what the modernist liberals would like to have. No, the Bible is too clear. The fire of hell is real, literal fire. And if that fire is real, literal fire, then the worm that Jesus is talking about is a real, literal worm. Hell is definitely a place where worms will wiggle and crawl forever. For while the unquenchable fire burns, he said, "Their worm dieth not." In Isaiah 66:24, it says, "Their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched." In that same book of Isaiah, in the 14th chapter, God speaks to Satan, and he says to him, "Hell from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. The worm is spread under thee, and the worms shall cover thee." Hell is a place where the fire never goes out, and the worms never die. Now, in this passage before us, I want you to look closely in verse 44, where he says, "Their worm dieth not." And then in verse 46, their worm dieth not. In verse 48, their worm dieth not. Notice that Jesus Christ uses the personal possessive pronoun their. Now, friend of mine, I believe that the Bible is inspired of God, every word, every letter, every jot, and every tittle. And God never wastes a stroke of his brush. Jesus Christ put the personal possessive pronoun on that word worm. Their worm, their worm, their worm. In Isaiah 66:24, their worm shall not die. Now there has to be a reason for that personal possessive pronoun, their. Well, there is a reason. I'm going to show you something tonight that will shock many of you. I'm going to show you with the Bible that the worm that never dies is that lost person himself. He deteriorates and degenerates into a worm. In Matthew 10:28, Jesus said, "Fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." Now the lost person who's never born again, goes through life, never gets born again, is never more than just soul and body. Only born again people have a spirit. We come into this world spiritually dead, depraved beings of only body and soul, and until you are born of the Spirit of God, you have no spirit, no contact with God whatsoever. To go through life without being born again, you go through life, soul and body. You die, the soul separates from the body, the soul goes to the flames of hell instantly, and the body goes into the grave. And that's the way it is until the second resurrection. At the second resurrection described in Revelation chapter 20, God will reach down into hell for the soul that's been burning there all of that time. He will remake the body in which that person died, and he will bring them together and put the soul and the body back together. They will stand before God and then alive be cast into the lake of fire, which is hell's final state. Now, Matthew 10:28, when it talks about the soul and the body, is hell's final state, because the soul and the body are not together in hell now, but in the lake of fire, the final state of hell. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7, teaching us about the soul of man, the Bible says that God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. However, in Mark 8:36, Jesus said, "What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" So you see, the Bible teaches us that man is the soul. At the same time, he possesses the soul. Man became a living soul. He can lose his personal possessive pronoun, his soul. In Mark 14:8, speaking of the woman who brought the alabaster box and broke it to anoint Jesus, Jesus said this, "She hath come to anoint my body to the burying." He used the personal possessive pronoun on the body in which he lived, my body. In John 11:34, he walks into the cemetery looking for the grave of his friend Lazarus, whose soul has already left the body, and yet Jesus said in that passage, "Where have you laid him?" Speaking of the body. And so in Bible language, the person is the soul, and he has, possesses the soul. In Bible language, the person is the body, and he has or possesses the body. The personal possessive pronoun, their soul, their body, and their worm. According to Matthew 10:28 and many other scriptures, all that a lost man has in hell in his final state in the lake of fire, all that lost man has and is in the lake of fire is body and soul. There is not a third anything. Body and soul in the lake of fire. Now, I'm going to show you from the Word of God that every lost person's body in the lake of fire will become like it was in its very first state when that person's body was conceived in his mother's womb. A worm. Their body, their worm, is one in the same thing. This is why Jesus used the personal possessive pronoun, their worm dieth not. He did not say, the worm dieth not. He said, their worm dieth not. Their soul, their body, their worm. Man in his natural state is a worm. Turn back to Job chapter 25 from the pages of the Word of God, and I'll show you that man in the Bible is called a worm. Job 25, verses 4 through 6. How then can man be justified with God? Or how can he be clean that is born of a woman? Behold, even to the moon, and it shineth not. Yea, the stars are not pure in his sight. How much less man that is a worm, and the Son of Man, which is a worm. The Bible declares that man is a worm and his children are worms. Mankind and worms are alike in many ways. Man in his natural state is much like a worm. I want to show you three ways in which the Bible correlates it. Men and worms, and when I say men, I mean mankind, not just the male species. Men and worms, first of all, are creatures of earth. To worms, everything is the earth, and the earth is everything. A worm lives for this earth. Isn't that right? Man in his natural state, and by that I mean he's never been born again, is the same way. Men and worms are creatures of earth. Unregenerate man lives only for this earth. All he cares about is what's right here, what he can grasp with his hands, what he can gain in this world, and gives no consideration to another world. 1 Corinthians 15:47, Paul said, the first man, Adam, is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. What did he say? Man is earthy. The earth is what he grasps. This world is what he lives for. It's like a worm. Now I'm going to make a medical statement, and it's absolutely fact, it is so, that sperm cell which housed your soul at the instant you were conceived in your mother's womb, that sperm cell is shaped exactly like a worm. In other words, the very first physical form that you had was that of a worm. No eyes, no hands, no feet. Just a little wiggling torso. That's how you started out. In the shape, in the form, the worm. The Bible says, as we read it, man is a worm, and his children are worms. Now go back to Job 17. Just a few pages back. In Job 17 and verse 14. Listen from the lips of Job. Job 17:14. I have said to corruption, thou art my father, to the worm, thou art my mother and my sister. What is Job saying? Job is saying, in the loins of my father and in the womb of my mother, I am a worm of corruption. And so are the others which came from the same place. Man is a worm. Like the worm, natural man is a creature of earth. Secondly, men and worms are alike in that they are creatures of darkness. Did you ever go out to an old lumber pile that's been there a long time and some of the boards have been scattered and sitting flat on the ground? And you go out and you pick up a board. What will you find under it? Worms. And the minute the light hits it, what do they do? They'll scatter. They'll head for cover. They want to get back to darkness. Worms are creatures of darkness. Worms have no eyes, but they are affected by the light. They are creatures of darkness. Worms are satisfied with darkness. They love darkness. So, it is true of unregenerate man. John 3:19-20, Jesus told Nicodemus, this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world and men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. Jesus says that unregenerate man loves darkness and will not come to the light, just exactly like a worm. When do the night crawlers come out? In the daytime? No, they come out in the darkness. Worms are creatures of the darkness. Worms love darkness. God says man is a worm. If he's never born again, his nature is never changed. He goes on as a worm, never has a different nature, dies as a worm. And as I shall show, you will degenerate into a worm in the lake of fire. And God says hell is a place of darkness, and it's filled with never dying worms. Men and worms are creatures of earth. Men and worms are creatures of darkness. Thirdly, men and worms are creatures of filth. In Mark chapter 9, where we read our original text, the Greek word Jesus used in that text for worm was skolex. And the word skolex literally means maggot. If you don't believe me, you go check it out yourself in a concordance or a lexicon. Skolex, maggot. Jesus said, where the fire is not quenched and the maggot, their maggot, that is, their maggot, their worm, never dies. Maggots thrive on germ-infested garbage, vermin, filth, and rotting carcasses. In Acts chapter 12, when you read that the worms ate the body of King Herod, skolex, maggots, ate his rotting body. Interestingly enough, maggots and germs go together. Have you ever looked at germs under a microscope? If you have, they're little worms, aren't they? Germs are worms, and I'm not even a poet. Now, hell is the germ-infested garbage dump and graveyard for rotting carcasses of the universe. In Revelation 21 and 27, the Bible says nothing can enter into heaven which would defile it. Germs would defile it. Filth would defile it. And so those who die in their sins cannot get into heaven, because they are a worm, a maggot, and maggots love filth. The unsaved man, woman, boy, or girl who in this life turned Jesus Christ away, refused with an entrance into their heart as their Savior, never were born again, never were regenerated, never were given that spiritual life and a nature like unto God's nature, go right on through life with that worm nature. Unsaved men, women, boys, and girls who thrived on the germ-infested garbage, vermin, and filth from rotting carcasses of this earth will spend eternity burning in the body of a bloated maggot. You, if you are not saved, and you go on without Christ as your Savior, and you die unsaved, your body will become that of a worm. You are the worm that never dies. Their soul, their body, their worm. Revelation 22:11, the Bible speaks of that person who was filthy on earth. He dies, he goes into the lake of fire, and it says, let him that is filthy be filthy still. The maggot, filthy, lover of garbage and vermin and the filth and the rotting carcasses of this old world. Remember that I said in Matthew 10:28, that's hell in its final state, which is the lake of fire. In Isaiah 66:24, where it said, their worm died not, that's hell in its final state. In Isaiah 14, where God said, hell to the devil, it's going to stir itself to meet you, and the worm will be under you, and the worms will cover you, that's hell in its final state, not as it stands tonight. Satan has never been in hell. People picture him down in hell and with a pitchfork and stabbing people, making them shovel coal. No, sir. He is a roaring lion moving about this earth seeking whom he may devour. He is not in hell. He has never been in hell yet. But he is going to hell. And when he goes, he'll go to hell in its final state, the lake of fire. Revelation 20:10 shows him being cast into the lake of fire. Now, during the millennium, he will be chained up in the bottomless pit, but he will not move into the burning hell proper until he is cast in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 10. People in heaven do not get their final glorified bodies until the first resurrection, when the trumpet sounds. People in hell do not get their final corrupted bodies until the second resurrection, when the soul is lifted out of the flames and the body is remade from the grave or from the sea and put back together to stand at the white throne and then be cast alive into the lake of fire. At the first resurrection, the saved man gets a body like his heavenly Father. Philippians 3:21, we shall have a body like his glorious body. 1 John 3:2 says we shall be like him. At the first resurrection, I'm getting a body like the body of my heavenly Father. At the second resurrection, the unsaved man gets a body like his devil father. John 8:44, Jesus said to lost people, you are of your father, the devil, and the Bible calls the devil that old serpent. That lost person will end up with a body like his devil father in its lowest form. The lowest form, in the shape of a serpent, is a worm. See, well, I don't think the serpent and the worm are related. All right, listen. In Psalm 22, this is the psalm of the cross. In the 22nd psalm, Jesus is hanging on the nails of the cross. And in verse 6, he says from the cross, I am a worm and no man. In John 3, speaking to Nicodemus in verse 14 and 15, Jesus said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but had eternal life. Did you catch the even so? As that serpent was put on that stick and raised into the air back there in Moses' day, even so Jesus said, I will be lifted up on a piece of wood myself. But when he told us how it was in Psalm 22:6, he was in the lowest form of the serpent. He said, I'm a worm. And no man. I want you to put your thinking cap on and think with me. What is the penalty for a person living this life, sinning against God, rejecting God's Son, and dying, what is his penalty? It's to spend eternity in hell, isn't it? Isn't that the penalty? Now, Jesus went to the cross to pay that penalty, didn't he? If Jesus paid the penalty for me, which was to spend eternity in hell, then beyond my comprehension and yours, we little creatures of time are so limited. But God is the Father of eternity, and he is the Master of time. If Jesus paid the penalty for you and for me, so we wouldn't have to spend an eternity in hell, then friend of mine, he did. He did. He spent an eternity in hell. I can't explain it, I can't understand it, but I know he had to, or I would still have to do it. That's the penalty. Jesus suffered an eternal hell for me on Calvary's cross. Do you remember? Psalm 22 starts out when the darkness is over the land. My God! My God! Why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus cried that when the darkness was over the world. During those 3 hours of darkness, Jesus Christ, mysteriously beyond our comprehension, but literally so, suffered an eternity of hell. And now he says, look at Psalm 22 and verse 6 if you want to see what you will become if you go to hell. What did he become when he suffered hell? What did he become when he was suffering hell for us? I am a worm! Then that will teach you and me what a person becomes when they go to hell. He showed you what you will eventually become if you die without him and go to hell. Oh, if you're here tonight and you've never been born again, and if you don't know what I mean by that, friend, you have never been born again. If there's never been a time in your life when you understood you were a lost sinner on the road to hell and no religion in this world could save your soul, there wasn't enough baptismal water to wash one sin away, that all the sacraments the churches have invented and say that it takes sins away is not so. If you've never come to the place in your life when you understood what the Bible says, you can't live good enough to go to heaven. You're dead in trespasses and sins. You must be born again, Jesus said. And if you've never come to that place where you understood that and then turned from your sins in repentance and turned from that old dead religion and called on Jesus Christ and invited him personally into your heart as your personal Savior, trusting only him, 100% him. If you've never done that, you're lost. You're still in an unregenerate state. You're alienated from God and you're headed for hell, and you will be the one that never dies. I beg of you tonight, don't go to hell and burn as a worm, where the fire will never quench, never stop burning you. And you can never die, never go out of existence. Years ago, there was an old Indian chief that got saved. Anybody that would come around the reservation, he'd tell them about Jesus. One day he was going to demonstrate to a crowd of people what Jesus had done for him. That old Indian took a bunch of dried leaves and made a perfect circle out of them. And then he just took his fingers and went down to the center and just scooted it back so there was a little bit of dirt showing. He walked over to a tree where a caterpillar was making its way up the tree, a worm. He took the worm off the tree and he carried it over and he put it down right in the center where that little piece of dirt was and all those leaves around that little worm. And he took a match. And he went around with that match and lit that pile of leaves all the way around. And the fire began to build up. The smoke began to come. And that little worm, though he had no eyes, began to sense the heat from that flame. He could hear the crackling of those leaves. And that little worm began to turn its head one way and the other. And it wasn't hard to tell. It was ready to panic. And the flames were closing in and closing in and closing in on that little worm. And when they got real, real close, where they were about to singe him, the old Indian chief reached down as the fire came toward him and picked that little worm out and said, "This is what Jesus do for me." That's exactly right. That's exactly right. Man who is a worm, closed in by the fires of hell and headed for hell without hope, is plucked like a brand from a burning by Jesus Christ. And then the chief took the worm, put him back on the tree, turned around to the people and said, "Worm, nestle in tree, make cocoon. In time from tree, come from cocoon, no longer worm. Beautiful butterfly, fly away." This is what Jesus do for me. Isn't that right? When you're born again, you see, that old word nature will be gone someday. And we'll learn something beautiful. Like when the Lord very heavenly Father, and then I'm going to fly away. This is what Jesus do for me. I want you to go back to Mark chapter 9 for a minute. I want you to say something. Let it grip your heart. Jesus says in verse 43, "If thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having two feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched." Those are solemn words. Now that word offended there means to cause to stumble. Jesus said, "Look at your hand. Is there something that your hand loves to do so much that it would cause you to turn away from me and not make me your Savior?" Then he said, "You take that hand and you lay it on the block. And you take a hatchet and whack it off. And watch it fall to the ground and watch the fingers spasm and curl and watch it flip and flop until finally it lays over and dies." He said, "Look at your foot. Are there places that your foot loves to take you so much that it would cause you to turn your back on me and say, 'I'd rather have that than Jesus?'" Then he said, "You go out and you lay your foot on the block and you take an axe and you lift it above your head and whack! You cut that foot off and it'll fall to the ground and watch it wiggle and spasm. Watch the tools curl when it flips and it pops and it leans over and dies." He says, "There's something that your eye just loves to feast upon so much that you would rather lust with that eye than turn to me and make me your Savior and escape hell." Then he said, "You take your remaining hand and you reach down into your eye socket and you get a hold of that eyeball and yank it out. It would be better for you to go through life with one hand and one foot and one eye and get saved and go to hell than go to hell with both eyes and both hands and both feet." He said, "Preacher, that's really awful." "Yeah, I know it is. But it's not my language. It's the language of the one that came to die to keep you out of that place. He ought to know what he's talking about." Now you think about this. What was mentioned in this passage? Hands, feet, eyes. Worms have no hands. Worms have no feet. Worms have no eyes. The evolutionists teach us that man started at the bottom and is working his way up and getting better and better and better. The Bible teaches us that man started at the top and fell. And is going downward all the time, getting worse and worse and worse and worse. Constantly degenerating. The real truth is de-evolution. Man is going back in his original state to how he started. You started in your mother's womb. The very first physical form you had was a worm. No hands, no feet, no eyes. You die without Christ. The angels will throw you in the lake of fire. And you will continue to degenerate until there are no more eyes, no more hands, no more feet. And your worm, which will be your body, will never die while it burns in unquenchable fire. But a worm does have a mouth.
And you don't have a mouth, so you can still see. And you can still cry. And you can still wail. And you still have thirst. And you can still gnash
your teeth. Oh, if you're not saved tonight, don't go to hell. Forget your religion. Forget your pride. You come tonight and receive Jesus into your heart, or you'll end up wiggling, screaming, spasming, burning, filthy worm. Cut off your hand if you have to. Cut off your foot. Pluck out your eye. But whatever it takes, pay the price and come to Jesus. Many years ago, there was a pirate ship on the high seas. This old pirate captain was a vicious and a wicked man, as most of them were. A storm caught the ship at sea and began to batter it until the masts collapsed and fell. And before they knew it, the ship was sinking. The old captain said, "Man the lifeboats! Man the lifeboats!" But before they could get to the lifeboats, all but one was crushed by the powerful sea. One lifeboat, not near enough for all the men. They dropped the lifeboat into the water. The captain picked the men that he wanted in the boat, picked enough that he knew that if he put any more in, it would sink, and stepped into the boat himself. Other men were clinging to the wrecked ship. "Take me, Captain! Take me! Don't leave me here!" They began to shove off from that sinking ship. The water was bobbing up right to the edge of that lifeboat. They figured if one more man got in it, it'd sink. And so they shoved off, and the others were clinging to the wreckage and going down, and some were already drowned. A few more clinging as it started to go down. One man jumped into the water, began to splash toward that lifeboat. He said, "No, Captain, let me in the boat. Let me live. I don't want to die. Let me live." The captain said, "Get back, get back. We've got enough men in the boat. One more would sink it. Get back." But that man wanted to live so bad, he came up the side of the boat, and he grabbed the hold with his hand. And the captain said, "Let go." He said, "No, I want to live." And that pirate captain pulled out his sword, and where that man was holding onto the side of the boat, down came the sword, cut his hand off. He slipped back into the water. He said, "No, Captain, let me in the boat. I don't want to die. I don't want to die. Let me live." And he reached up with the other hand, and the sword came down, cut off the other hand. And he slipped back into the water. And he came up with those bloody stripes and said, "Captain, let me live." The men said, "Captain, Captain, don't let him drown. Look what he's done. He's laying. Give his hands to me. Pull him in. We'll take a chance." And they pulled that bleeding man into the boat. And he lived. Because he wanted to live so bad, he would even let his hands be chopped off before he would give up. Jesus said, "If your hand offends you, cut it off. If your foot offends you, cut it off. If your eye offends you, pluck it out. But whatever you do, come to me and be saved. Lest you go to the place where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched."